Please begin.
Yes. Good morning, everyone. I am Saravanan Palaniswamy. I am working in Intel for past 2.5 years in the BMC manageability domain, and I have overall software industry experience 15 years, of which 18 years I worked in the server-related products and software projects. So today I am going to talk about IPMI in OpenBMC. Okay. So agenda for today is introduction to IPMI and what are the IPMI services running in OpenBMC, and what are the interfaces IPMI basically uses, and then some key features we touch upon, and then IPMI architecture and source code, and then how we can override the commands and opportunities for contribution. Okay, this is just a random picture. Just like you see some natural scenery and this thing, I will come to this later. Okay, IPMI introduction. IPMI is abbreviated as Intelligent Platform Management Interface. It's almost 650 plus pages document, so it's not possible to cover all the aspects in this 1 hour. So I touch upon the key things in this. And why we needed is it's basically a set of specification to reduce the total cost of ownership of server management. By standardizing it, it was created in 1998. So basically someone would need to manage the data center servers remotely. They can, they need some standardized way. So this IPMI concept came in and this specification was developed. So what it is, it defines a standardized, abstracted, extensible, message-based interfaces to the platform management subsystem. And it defines interfaces for both in-band and out-of-band. In-band means, so some disclaimer before, this is more like, most people may aware of it, but the learning series target is for the anyone joining the IP, newly into the project. So please, forgive me if it is already known things to you. I'm just going with the flow just like that. So in-band means the traffic originating from the board, usually with the knowledge of the CPU or OIS. And whereas out-of-band is, it's coming from the external remote controller to the BMC, which may not be known to the host CPU. And so it's a set of specifications. So it related specifications are IPMB, ICMB, and FRU related specifications. And IPMB is nothing but IPMI over I2C based serial bus. And it's this bus is usually routed between various system modules in our server board to connect the modules. And what it does, it's basically five things: monitoring, recovery, logging, alerting, and inventory. So monitoring of electrical or thermal sensors in your server platform, and recovery if something goes hanging, you can do the chassis power cycle reset options. And logging is logging any abnormal event is happening, it need to be logged into the system event log. And then alerting is alerting the users in the remote console using SNMP traps or some mechanism so that some abnormal event happening is known to the user. And the inventory is keeping track of the items available in the board. For example, power supply unit, who is the manufacturer, what is the serial number, and all those things by reading the FRU details. Are you able to hear me? I'm not sure.
Yes, Saravanan, very clear.
Okay, fine. Yeah. And BMC is a baseboard management controller, is part of the platform management subsystem. It is an autonomous microcontroller, operates on standby power, placed besides the main processor in the server board. It is always on and maintaining the system, independent of host machine, CPU, and its software. So as you know that we need to manage the server system irrespective of the host CPU's condition. So we need an extra microcontroller fixed in the board, which can monitor the board and other sensor services. So that is basically a BMC here. And it also have a NVMe storage to store the SDR. SDR means sensor data records, system event logs and field replacement unit information. Okay, so what is the evolution of IPMI? So it was created in 1998 and version 1.5 2001 2004 2013. So this is the past, and here you can see in the Wikipedia what are the features added. The feature is written in the wall, like no further updates to the IPMI specifications are planned. And this is from the consortium that IPMI who initially developed by Dell, HPE, NEC and Intel Corporation. So whoever want to use the manageability, they need to go to the DMTF Redfish. Still we need IPMI for supporting the legacy systems and the legacy system data center management softwares which rely on the IPMI. So that's why we have this implemented in OpenBMC also, but slowly it will be, we will transition to the Redfish for the security and scalability perspectives, which is superior in this nature. For a new user, like these are some example implementations of IPMI. BMC is a microcontroller, as I told. This ASP-DST2500 is one such microcontroller which can give functionalities for implementing this IPMI. And IPMI stack is implemented by many vendors, like HPE have named it as ILO, Dell and IBM, and our Linux Foundation OpenBMC also I listed here. And in order to execute the IPMI commands and see its behavior, you can use the utilities like IPMI tool, which is integrated into the OpenBMC firmware itself, so that you can run these commands from the BMC serial console. Otherwise, even in a normal Linux systems also it is available, and IPMI util is available in the Windows-based machines, which can, you can, from the remote Windows-based machines, you can run these IPMI util commands and access IPMI functionality. Yeah, any questions so far? Okay. So this is the IPMI block diagram as it is taken from the IPMI specification. some of the things were like not relevant for today. For example, this modem is like a low speed line which was needed at the time of say 20 years back. So which mostly we don't use modem to communicate to BMC these days. We will use the network LAN controller to reach to the BMC from the out of band traffic. So, and this is the motherboard, and we have a CPU and connected to the BMC through this system bus. And there can be a private management buses to access the memory board or CPU board, which have the to read the memory through details. So this is privately securely managed, securely can be accessed by BMC alone. And it have the non-volatile storage to store the cell SDR and FRU information. And this is satellite controller, which is like chassis management controller. Satellite means it's an auxiliary controller basically, which can do the functionality of baseboard management, and these two guys can interact together and then provide that functionality. So this can also be abstracted into this baseboard management controller in the boards like chassis mount, rack mount servers. Usually this component may not be present, maybe more applicable to the blade server systems. Yeah, these are all some typical components. So the thing I want to highlight here is it's a spec which is agnostic to the host CPU, host OS, and in the hardware interface it is trying to connect. So it defines the message formats, and that message formats can be sent over any kind of interface. So this is one interface, network LAN controller. It's like normal RJ45 Ethernet cable. And this is system bus is usually ESPI or LPC physical layer will come. And these are all like I2C lines, which runs the IPMP protocol, which can access the other peer controllers or this kind of sensors also can be accessed. And there is a PM bus protocol which is running to access the PSU details. And it supports basically a different kind of interfaces in this. Okay. So it's a message-based interface, and all IPMA messages share the same fields in the message payload, irrespective of in which interface it's transferred over. And the different system interface types are KCS, SMIC, BT, and SSIF. So KCS is like a keyboard controller style protocol, like as if you are typing in the keyboard, if you are receiving the byte streams, and how it is managed, the protocol to flow control this thing, the same kind of similar protocol is used, is called KCS. And IPMA messaging uses a request response protocol, and request means comments in other words. And IPMA comments are grouped based on their functionality using a field called network function code. So you have a lot of functionality, so we need some organized way of these things. So we have chassis related commands and sensor related commands and like that. So all these commands have a net function value assigned to it. And then request messages usually have an even number and command and optional fields. And response messages carry network function, request message, command, and request message net function plus one, which is an odd number basically, and optional data official code. So this is one example request, net function, and len is part of this thing. Len is a logical unit number, which is like out of 8 bits, 2 bits is assigned to the logical unit number. Usually it will be 00 to denote the BMC. It can be 01, 10, or 11 if it implemented to denote any other logical entity residing in the BMC. And net function is, as I told, it based basically the group that command belongs to. And the command is given here, and then data is passed, which some commands may not require any data. And this is the response message format. So net same here. Okay, so touch and feel is like, this is how your get device ID command will feel. Like I executed this command in the BMC serial console. So you feel like it's all numbers basically. So it's not really user friendly to execute these commands. And understanding this, you may need to refer the spec and these things. So it was okay some 20 years back considering the less network bandwidth and the software paradigms available at the time. But now we move to the Redfish, and anyhow, we have some user-friendly wrappers provided by IPMA utilities like IPMA tool, which can decipher this information and present it in some nice way. For example, the same command can be executed as IPMA tool machine info, and then it can display the same details in a better way. Okay, coming to the LAN message format, basically it's out of band. I am taking this interface as the target. So it will have Ethernet MAC address and then IP UDP wrapper. And then it will have a RMCP message because it's the application layer protocol is RMCP plus, in this case, RMCP, RMCP plus. And then a session wrapper, and then it will have the same payload, net function, lens, as if we have given here. This is the net function plus LAN, and then this is the, this is the net function plus LAN, and this is the command. So here net function is application anyhow. So net function and LAN, and then command and data, like this, it will come here. So here I'm just showing it for the reference purpose, how the RMCP plus session is established. This is detailedly covered in the spec, basically a remote entity which wants to communicate with the BMC first need to establish a session which will go through a sequence of steps like get channel authentication capabilities, get supported cipher suites, and then it will send a open SSN request, and then it will give you a key, and it will have to encrypt the username, and these kind of steps are there. So to see what is happening behind the screens, you can always use IPMI2Life and VB. As much verbose you add, that much information you will get it to understand the sequence of steps going behind the screens. And these are all some of the cipher suites supported in specified in the IPMI. So this is authentication algorithm, confidentiality, integrity, and authentication algorithm. Right now, OpenBMC supports only cipher suit ID 17, which have this thing for the security reasons. And this is the common network function codes grouped together, zero, chassis, bridge, and app form storage like this. So this is the first picture I shown is just my memory aid for this understand to remembering these net functions. So first one is that some bridge, and second one is sense app some logos like community project something. And the third one is the FIST. So chassis 0x0, bridge is 0x2 because 0x1 is the odd number, which is the response to the command coming under net function chassis. And so by remembering this memory aid at any point in time, you can easily remember, okay, which net function this incoming command belongs to like this. Okay. And these are all the completion codes of IPMI. So 00 is usually a success. It's completed normally. If it is this kind of error number, either it's invalid command or parameters are out of range or invalid data field in request, like that, the requester can get to know what is the response he is getting. By seeing the code, he can correct the request command basically. Coming to the OpenBMC IPMI, any questions so far? This is until now, it's all about IPMI. Okay. Coming to the OpenBMC IPMI, so key thing is like channel and user management. So this is covered in this architecture document. I did not open it. So this Richard took a session on a user manage this user management in this learning series first. So, but that is takes care of both IPMI and Redfish. So basically, it defends the privileges. IPMI spec defends the privileges callback, user, operator, administrator, and these privileges can be configurable per channel as well as per user. So whenever some request comes from some user in some particular channel, say the user is having a privileged user, but the channel is not the, it's like just a operator level privilege, then the minimum of these two is operator. That privilege only that command will go and execute basically. And the configuration, some of the example configuration, suppose if you want to configure a IPMI stack in your OpenBMC, these are all some configurations where it is defined. So channel config.json, basically IPMI defines 16 channels in the spec. So some channels are reserved, some channels can be configured, some channels are predefined, like it should be like this. So in this case, for example, channel 1, 2, 3 is like ETH0, ETH1 channel, which is like out of band traffic for our Ethernet interfaces. And these channels support the session. Basically, since the traffic is originating from the remote user, we need to authenticate the user before allowing the commands to execute. And it supports the multiple sessions also, basically. So that property is defined here, session supported like this. So this IPMB is sessionless. This is the traffic originating from the inside the board. And here the KCS channel is defined, which is also a sessionless channel, basically a traffic originating from the BIOS to the BMC. And this channel 14 is something like a special channel. It will tell like whatever the current channel in which this command is executed like this.
Yeah. Quick question, Saravanan.
Yes.
In this case, is this defined by the IPMS spec or it's implementation by the OpenBMC that defines these 16 channels?
It's defined by the IPMI spec. There it's like, it doesn't say, it says some channels should be reserved like that. The channel number, this should be reserved channel like that. And right. Some channels can be, like it says it should be for the KCS purpose, for IPMB like that. So okay. It's like, it gives the flexibility to define some channels. It says some channels are reserved like that.
Yeah, if I have like say, SMS system management is KCS and BT and like SMIC. You know, if I have multiple system interfaces, does it allow us to kind of define different channel numbers? How do you implement that? If you have like say KCS and BT.
I actually don't know how in this case it can be handled. If someone in bridge can help in that, I can. Okay. I mean,
that is fine. Yeah, I just want to kind of see, is this implementation specific or the protocol, you know, IPMI specifies, pre-assigns the numbers?
These channels meant for reserved can be used, but I am not sure on that. I need to refer the spec.
That's fine. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
Another question I have is what channel we use for a communication between host to that BMC? In band
is this KCS channel.
So, but this you said for BIOS only, or is this same for host as well?
Yes.
So then, what is the channel zero for IPMB? So that's also in band, right?
That is for communicating with. Other devices in that, for example, it's for the I2C device, over I2C device, this IPMB channel is used.
Okay, so any IO device is connected to the board?
Yes, correct.
So if you go down to the channel 15 again.
Okay.
And so if you see the channel 14, you say self. What is that?
Okay, so suppose you want to get the channel information. Suppose you are executing get channel info command. Okay, mm-hmm. There is IPMI command called get channel info or get user info. Mm-hmm. So in that you need to specify the channel number, for example. So in that, if you say that channel number is 14, you will get the channel in which this command is executed. For example, if the command is coming via the OOB LAN interface, it will say the channel, that output response will say the channel name is OOB network. If it comes via the in-band, it will say the channel is 15 SMS like that. Okay. Basically to identify the channel.
Okay.
In which the request is received.
Okay. Thanks.
And a list of supported cipher suite is defined here, cipherlist.json. And as I told, it's only cipher 17 is supported now for the security reasons. And devid.json, for example, it's like get device ID command when we are executing, it need to get some static information like manufacturer ID, product ID, and all those things. But this need to be implementers need to append their information with the patch or something in the Yocto, this particular file basically. So like that, most of the properties are configured as JSON files in this thing. And we also allow like whitelisting some commands or blacklisting some commands, which is defined in this host IPMID whitelist.conf basically. So here one should add the command so that that command get executed. Otherwise, it says it's blacklisted. It's a provision available in this phosphor host IPMID. Okay, this is like
user. What is the reason for that whitelisting? Why can't we just assume all the commands to be like rather than having a blacklist, why do we define a whitelist which is long?
Okay. That is that also a good idea, but I don't know the reason why they choose the blacklist or why they choose the whitelist instead of the blacklist.
Okay, but the only
purpose... I think that was a security guideline there. So blacklist, so instead of assuming every command is good and blacklisting only some commands, security gives us the reverse assumptions. We assume whatever is in whitelist are the only good commands, and whatever is blacklist is, whatever is not in the list is bad by default.
When you mean by good command means it is being implemented, right?
Yes.
Okay. It's allowed command basically.
Okay. But if you don't put a whitelist or any list, the simple answer should be just the response should not come again. If we are not able to map any command implementation, can't we just remove reply back saying not implemented or not applicable because there's a response type like that?
Basically, I understand like if you blacklist some commands, the space of allowed commands is more.
And my question is not that now. My question now is why do we even need any such file? Because if any such command coming and IPMID sees that that command, there is no binding to that command, there is no application, API is available, it can simply return back saying there is nothing available or not implemented.
Okay. This is like we allow the commands for certain time. For example, when the BMC and BIOS boot up, for example.
Okay.
So during the boot up time, BIOS need to communicate with the BMC to understand what device ID of the BMC and all those things. So in that case, we will allow the commands to come to the BMC and execute it. But after some time, those commands has to be blacklisted. So to make that provision, this thing is provided. So okay. Once the system is secured, these kind of commands will be blacklisted, and those commands won't be allowed. None of the commands will be allowed.
Okay. So this whitelist become a blacklist after some time.
Yes, there is a separate property for that to do that. But I am not sure that it will touch this file or it will just say blacklist all the commands in this channel.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. So adding to what Saravanan was explaining, so the whitelist commands will have all the IPMA commands that we support. But the only change is if we see there is one more called there is one more Intel implementation of the same. So how we do there is from the all one complete IPMA command list, there are certain commands which are not allowed to execute in host in some of the channels at some point of time. For example, as Sharanun was explaining, when BIOS booting time, we need to allow some higher privilege commands, which we do not need to allow once the BIOS completed booting. Okay, such commands we will, as per the channel, we will block at a particular time. So the whitelist will have all the commands, but it says which command should not be allowed in which channel at what point of time. So such configuration we can do using that one.
So whitelist have that option of configuring that level of execution.
Yes.
Okay.
So so the first ipmate-whitelist.conf don't have the complete channel-based filtering, but there is Intel IPMA OEM. We have one more complete implementation where we have a channel-based filtering also.
Okay.
So, which basically in all channels, all commands are not allowed to execute at all time.
Okay.
So this is like displaying the user list in channel number 3. For example, 3 is the LAN channel. So user ID name and his channel privilege limit. And yeah, like this, we can configure the users also. This is supporting 15 users as per the spec in IPMI. So this is the architecture of IPMI in OpenBMC. So this is IPMI daemon. This is a daemon which simply expects the net function, LAN, and those things. It's like interface independent. So here are the interfaces. One is the KCS interface, and here is the LAN interface. So the commands coming via this KCS or BT will be sent to this guy. And similarly, the commands coming from the LAN will be coming here. So one is, this is called Phosphor IPMI net. So this guy, this service takes care of authenticating the sessions. And then once the system is established, it can send the command, forward the command to this, basically this daemon, so that it this daemon is free of just doing the one job, getting the request and then sending it to the other. Here it is mentioned, debug services do work on behalf of IPMI commands. For example, you want to get the get device ID, which need to get the software version. It may go to your service, which can provide that information, mostly the Phosphor software manager or something. And then it can get the response and then send it back to the originating interface, either this or this, like this. And apart from that, SOL is also managed by this Phosphor IPMI net. And SOL is a serial over LAN, so it will send the BIOS serial traffic as a payload in the IPMI packet. So that is managed by this Phosphor IPMI net. So these are all some key services in IPMI. So I think I can go to this. Yeah, here this architecture is defined here. So IPMI is made up of commands and channels. Commands are provided by providers and channels are, this is called the bridges basically. And commands are provided by providers, which means that response is provided by these kind of providers. And here we define like IPMI messages that just passed to and from the IPMI daemon are basically the equivalent of IPMI tool raw commands, which I showed in the example before, with a little bit more information about the context. So LAN net function command and these three things as it is, and data, these four things are passed from for example, this LAN or something, after removing all the outer layer packets to here. And in addition to this, we will be passing like user ID of the user who initiated this command, and then zero, that user ID is zero for the sessionless channels like KCS. And privilege of the user, privilege of the it is like must be less than or equal to the that I told that minimum calculation, minimum of the minimum privilege of channel as well as the user. So that will be passed here. And in addition to this, it will pass the channel as in which channel this information is received. It's also passed. So this is the message data, and response data is completion code and the response data. So as I told, this channel bridge upon receiving a command will extract the fields, and then it will establish the sessions if it is called the RMCP plus session based channels, and then send the and encodes them in dbus method called to send them to the IPMI daemon. So this information is passed as a dbus method call to the IPMI daemon, because it's like within the BMC all communication is through the dbus calls. So I will come to this. I will cover the some other things also. So this basically tells how this is done in the code. Like, we have optional arguments which can say some request may have optional data field, some responses may have optional data field, so which we can cover using this std colon optional. So this is like C++ advantage. So these are all the, some of the key services in running in IPMI. So as I shown before, this is IPMID is running here, phosphor IPMI host.service. This is the corresponding service file for this. And this KCS 3 and 4 is running here as a separate services. KCS 3 is for the SMS, and KCS 4 is for SMM traffic. And then ETH 0 and ETH 1 is for the OOB traffic. And IPMB is for the I2C IPMB bridge, IPMB.service, any device which is like I2C, I told before. And user manager is for managing the user things, like channel and user privileges. That authentication, not the authentication, that Richard took the presentation, right? And logging is for the cell logging services. So the core functionality, just the architecture we defined, we saw before, these three things are coming here in the phosphor IPMI.host and KCS and ETH0 functions. This is some example KCS flow, like the command is sent from here, either through the eSpy or LPC physical medium, and then eSpy driver in the kernel space will be initialized during the BMC boot up, and waiting for, this is a ASP2500 specific, so please ignore this channel 3 and all this thing here. So it basically waits for the KCS communication. And once it receives, the driver will send the, here what I am showing is the IPMI daemon is running here, whereas there is another daemon, phosphor IPMI KCS, which will receive this request and then send it to the IPMI. And then IPMI will service it through sending the request to some other services, like if it is a get device ID command, it will go to the some other service which can provide that, and then responds back in the same flow. So here the KCS protocol is running, which takes care of serializing the incoming request. Basically, BIOS cannot send the next command until the previous command is responded. Okay, this is for overriding the IPMI commands. For example, get device ID is by default defined in phosphor IPMI host as and the same command. For example, anything in phosphor in OpenBMC is like a reference implementation, which can be, so phosphor host IPMID implement this command get device ID, with the priority of OpenBMC. Basically, when you register the command, there is a field called priority. So in that, you can specify, I can show in the code. Yes, this is how the registration of the commands happen. Basically, the register app function, register handler, and here every command is registered like this. So this is an example of get device ID. So it registers priority and then net function, app or chassis or what kind of category this command belongs to, and then what is the ID, that number assigned for this particular command, and then what is the privilege level for minimum privilege level required to execute this command. And this is the handler function. So like this, every module, every registration is happening for all the IPMI commands. So here, by tweaking this priority field, one can override the existing implementation. For example, in this case, Phosphor host IPMID have an implementation. Yes, so see here you can see a lot of commands, get device ID, everything is registered in the same format, similar way. And here it is registered with the priority OpenBMC base, which is like base 10. And the same command is defined again. This is in the Phosphor host IPMID repo. The same is defined again in the Intel IPMI OEM repo. So in this case, we are defining at the OEM base level, so which is priority 20. So when it is registered, IPMI will take care of taking the highest priority item is the handler for this command. So the command will be routed to that particular handler, and then by that, whoever want to override the reference implementation commands, they can do that this way.
So how does this priority thing works? Like, what is the main use of priority?
Yeah, as I told, like this, I show an example here. Get device ID is, I want to override the get device ID command. Basically, get device ID in the Phosphor IPMI host, I want to change like product ID or some other field computation is coming from some method. For example, it is a reference implementation, go and look for some particular X, Y, Z file. Whereas I want to refer the ABC file to read the product ID. So in that case, I can define my own version of get device ID command in my OEM. So here it is Intel IPMI OEM. I think Facebook have its FB IPMI OEM. So there you can go ahead and then register the handler, but you need to define the priority as little higher than the base priority. So reference implementation have the priority as 10. When you define, you should use OEM base. If you are a OEM, so ODM can override it with the ODM base like that. So it is by priority that handler will be over it. You want to know the implementation details or?
I got it. My question only was like, so you are just trying to say that, and I implemented this, I know that part. I was just trying to understand, if I put the same priority, like the test, the 10 number base, so will which API will be called, the standard function or the overridden one?
You mean you are putting the same number in both overriding place and here?
Okay. Yes.
That I have experimented this. It is basically the order of registration.
Okay.
I see the older implementations. So in this case, I am not sure it have any error handling to report like something is happening like this in the compiler level or in the registration level itself. Okay. Or it may silently override with the whatever coming in the latest.
Okay.
Identity.
Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. So these are all some of the different type of request and response lengths. So the IPMI request can be in a different sizes. Some may have data or may not have data, and responses also like based on the different parameter selectors, it may have optional sizes. So these and all can be achieved. These are all some examples of this. So this command is example for request is also fixed length and response is also fixed length. So request is a array of 8 bits and the username and password. It is trying to activate the user basically. And response is also fixed. It's unsigned int ADT and unsigned int ADT. And one more thing you would have noticed here is the APIs here are the traditional C way of doing this is keeping this in a structure, username and password for defining a structure for this particular request. And then we will pass the structure. But with OpenBMC, we do away. Some commands are still implemented in that format. But we really don't need to define those kind of structures. This argument itself flexible enough. You can even define unsigned int 1T, 2T like this. So if there is a bit, you need to pass. So by that, if there is any mismatch in the received arguments, that command will fail there itself. So this is one difference from the traditional way of sending the passing the commands from one function to the other function. So like this, there are examples like fixed request data length and whereas the response is the variable length. So in that case, I will be using the optional paradigm of the C++. And variable request data length will variable response data length. So there also, here there is a pack call is used for this payload.pack and payload.unpack, which is basically payload is variable size entity. So these are all some of the examples for the, these are all the places where you need to look for the files. So these are all the repo names and app handler.cpp implement all the application level commands, chassis handler.cpp for chassis level commands, transport handler.cpp, chassis handler will do chassis power on, off, reset, power cycle, and all those kind of commands. App handler application is for get device ID. And any general application commands. Transport handler is for LAN OOB related, setting the LAN configuration, getting the LAN configuration like that. And then storage handlers is for through SDR related commands and the firmware commands also available. And one more thing I just need to cover in this Phosphor host IPMID is okay, this is the core function we were talking about here. This guy, IPMID daemon is running starting from this place, IPMID new.cpp main function. So here he connects to the system bus and based on the services, if he passed any arguments, he processes it here and then coming down and then registers here, he loads some shared libraries, which is like user management and those things can be shared across Phosphor IPMI host and net. So those are implemented as shared libraries, which is loading here. And then And here he request for the service XYZ Open BMC project IPMI.host. So whoever sending a request, whoever want to get the IPMI service, they need to send the request to this service. And he registers the method execute, which we'll call execution entry. So whoever want to get the execution from the IPMI, they will send the DBus method call to this service with the execute method call. So it will go to the execution entry. Okay. So when it go to the execution entry, we have a yield thing. So here we need to be very careful about is these are all asynchronous calls. So suppose this IPMID receives a request one, and then it calls this execution entry, and then it goes down here, get the center, and then check the channel, whether channel is valid, and then whether this channel support the sessions, like these checks are done. And then if it is a, it's like channel specific checkings. Finally, it make a request to execute IPMI command. He creates the context and then sends the request. So this command can goes asynchronously. So if there is another request comes in between, so he will again service that command, and then that will also come and send the execute IPMI command. Mostly this will go to the another service to get the response. So in between, the order of who completes first cannot be determined. So SDBus plus and this SEO library will determine by yield context, which is completing first, and it will return accordingly. So the only thing is the designer should keep in mind that order of execution can be in any order. So if they use some global variables or something they are manipulating, modifying in the code, they should not assume that it is coming serially. So they need to protect it with some lock or some other mechanisms so that the command is executed serially if they want to execute. If that order of execution is needed like that. So this is needed for improving the performance because the commands need not block somewhere to the first command need not block until the second command, second command need not block until the first command is completed like this. So this is one point we need to keep in mind. And this is the general flow of the also. And these are all the references and yeah, questions.
Hi, Saravanan. I have a question regarding the cell. The cell implementation in the Intel IPMI OEM is different than the Fosfor IPMI host, right?
Need not be. Someone can override it. So you are saying Intel IPMI OEM in particular?
Yes.
Are you saying, okay. I think yes, but I need to check that. So you have any specific question in that?
Yes, yes. In Intel IPMI OEM, the cell is stored with the object name of the sensors.
Mm-hmm.
If you're aware of that, I can proceed the question.
Yeah, I think wider audience also may answer it. So
okay, fine. Okay, fine. So when we log a cell entry.
So okay. just to answer your question, the general Fosfor IPMI host IPMID doesn't have fully implemented SELs logs, cell logs. That's why if you see the cell logs are being implemented by different like FB IPMI OEM or Intel IPMI OEM differently. So like the Fosfor host IPMID, if you look into the code, that cell logs are not completely implemented as per the spec. Now I can answer another question if you have.
Yes. Yeah. My main question is, the cell entry is stored as a DBus object for the sensor instead of the sensor number, because in Intel IPMA OEM, the sensor number is calculated at the runtime, right?
Yes.
So let us suppose we have an issue with the PSU. There will be a cell entry log, okay? And we are removing the PSU, and then the OpenVMC is rebooting. So when the OpenVMC is rebooting, there won't be any object for the PSU because PSU is not present. So when I try to read the cell entry, how the sensor number will be calculated for the previously logged cell entry?
Okay, that's a very specific to the implementation, but if I remember correctly, Intel IPMI OEM also implements the sensors HDR, where they maintains all the HDR informations. So all the sensors names are mapped to that serial numbers. And that's from there, like if you see that there is a file called sensors.cpp. So sensor commands.cpp or something like that. There you can find that information. And I have not gone much details into the implementation, but that's how they maintain all the HDR from that Intel IPMI OEM.
The SDR and cell is only for the sensors present. So if the entity itself is not present, right, when we get the IPMI tool sensor command, it won't list the sensors where the entity is not present. So in case if the POC is not present, it won't list, right? So in that case, if I try to read the cell entry,
Did you try the IPMI tool SDR command, IPMI tool -VV SDR?
Even the SDR command also, it will list only the sensor which are present currently, okay? It won't list the sensor which is not present. So my main worry is if there is a cell entry which was previously logged, and if the sensor is not present, then how are we going to get the sensor number for the sensor which is not currently present?
Okay, I think this is a valid question. Like you have the older entry, but that mapping is gone now after boot up. So I need to check that, because SDR is it's like keep changing. I suppose it's a fixed thing, but you are saying that it is populated based on the current available sensors. We need to check that actually.
Yeah, thank you. Probably I'll connect with you offline.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions?
I had a question. I don't know if it's going to be excessively specific, but I've been looking into porting OpenVMC to a new platform and investigating getting things like thermal sensors supported via IPMI. And looking at the phosphor host IPMID, it looks like, from what I can tell, the sensors are statically configured in at compile time, as opposed to like discovered at runtime through Entity Manager or something. Is there any chance you could explain a bit about how that configuration works?
Okay. If you see the Entity Manager, I think faced James Tech presentation in this learning series about how these sensors are configured. So in short, these sensors data records are configured as JSON file entries. So if it is a WolfPass, it will be named something like wft_baseboard.json file.
I'm somewhat familiar with Entity Manager, but what it appears is that the phosphor host IPMID does not use the Entity Manager information. It looks like it has a set of sensors statically configured in at compile time. From a YAML file in the host IPMID repo. Is that
okay? Which specific IPMI command you are trying? And every IPMI tool sensors command is failing for you, or any specific command?
When I run like IPMI tool sensors list against it, it gives me back a whole bunch of sensors that aren't physically present. They're just, it's like a an example set that's got nothing to do with the actual hardware. And I looked into where that was coming from, and it's from, it looks like it's from this one YAML config file that just has a bunch of sort of dummy sensors hard coded into it, basically.
Yeah, by the way, I know which board you are trying to use, because I used only the Intel implementation. So I mean, whatever. Vijay, you can proceed.
Yeah, so the same question, like, are you using, which platform you are using for?
Well, we're porting to a new platform internally. Okay. It's an ASRock custom.
Yeah.
19.
Yeah, so that's okay. That's a very good question you're asking, and it's a problem. It's an issue. I have reported that issue into the Fosfor host IBM ID. Does not connect with entity manager implementation of the sensors, and Intel IPMI OEM takes care of override that sensors command. So it does take care of whatever the entity manager implementation has done. So we have to move that portion of code to the Fosfor host IPM ID so that it can detect both YAML as well as that entity manager implementation. Right now, you are absolutely right that currently it only connects whatever listed into the YAML file, precompiled, and it doesn't find that runtime entity manager listed sensors. So if, as Saravanan was explaining, because Intel IPMI OEM overrides that sensors command, and in that command, they implement the like a runtime dynamic listing of the sensors based on configuration files from the entity manager.
Okay, so would adding the Intel IPMI OEM package to our build provide access to entity manager defined sensors?
Yes.
Via IPMI?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. All right. I'll experiment with that. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Vijay.
But keep in mind that if you add Intel IPMI OEM, it does override several other standard commands also. Yes. So you will, the side effect of that would be that be ready for this.
That architecture basically compatible with your board. I mean, that way that commands are used, you need to look. Otherwise, you may need to comment out those, whatever offending, that registration of this, those commands probably can help. Okay. But I don't know how much is the volume of commands you need to do like that.
Okay.
But we are in the process of fixing. I already issued, I raised this issue of sensor into the Fosfor host IPMID. Based depending on that availability, we'll fix those into the main repo.
Okay, great, thanks.
Thank you. Yeah, I think that's all for today. If there is any more question, thanks all for your valuable time to share here.
Thanks a lot, Saravanan.
Thanks.
Thank you for sharing.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Bye. Yeah, thank you.
Bye.